Urban Education, Issues and Solutions. Our guest today is Dr. Sonia Horsford of George Mason University. Thank you, Sonia, for joining us today.
Thanks for having me.
We're going to be talking about educational leadership. That's your area of expertise. But we're framing it in terms of the symposium that you and Rodney Hobson primarily were the engines for putting together here on campus, looking at Brown v. Board of Education decision 60 years after the fact. Why don't we start with a debrief of the symposium for people who didn't have the opportunity to attend?
Sure. Well, the symposium took place on April 29th on campus, and we had a film screening of Stolen Education, which is a film that was produced by a friend and colleague named Enrique Aliman, who's in the Education Leadership Department at University of Utah. Along with a panel discussion that included Congressman Bobby Scott, Gabriel Asheru Ben, who performs the theme music to the Boondocks series, and Dr. Hobson served as the chair of the event.
Right.
And so we had a really engaging discussion around celebrating the 60th anniversary of the Brown decision and what that meant for schools, families, and communities 60 years later. They shared some really interesting perspectives from Asheru's practitioner perspective to that of a policymaker, which Congressman Scott shared, and then also Dr. Aliman's perspective as not only a professor but as a filmmaker in sharing the school desegregation story of his mother, who was a plaintiff at the age of 7 in Texas around a case where Mexican students were prohibited from attending schools with their Caucasian peers.
Right, right. And we often think about the Brown decision as only benefiting African-American students or the plaintiffs being African-American. But in fact, at the time, all kids of color were part of the segregation of schools. It was part of the law of the land. I understand that the symposium was a real revelation for a lot of Latino students in particular who hadn't heard the story of segregation against Mexican Americans and understanding how that connects to their realities today.
Yeah, I think it was a great learning experience for everyone who was able to attend, even the other panelists. And I regret that I forgot Dr. James Peterson, who was at Lehigh University, who also joined us. But hearing those unspoken histories of segregated education for Mexican-American students, I think, helped to create a bridge across communities and cultures. As you mentioned, we often think of the Brown decision as serving Black students and families. But through Dr. Aliman's film, he visually was able to share this history that was very similar to what we hear about when we hear the counter stories of African Americans who were not able to attend integrated schools. And that, I think, provided a nice space and common ground for two communities that may not think of their histories as being similar, but in fact right. are around issues
and
of education.
It was standing room only in this space.
It was. Yeah. We were delighted to have so many different community members and stakeholders there, people from the College of Education who helped to sponsor the event, as well as high school students that came from Fairfax County, as well as some of our own students here at Mason. So it was a nice cross-section of attendees, and we were delighted at the interest that the campus community had.
It kind of speaks to the continuing interest that people have in these kinds of stories. I mean, we're still living the legacies of policy decisions that were made 60 years ago, and we're still trying to puzzle through why it is that we don't have educational equity in 2014 that was the promise of the Brown decision. Mm-hmm. And some of that has to do with educational leadership, the extent to which educational leaders shape what happens in schools, in classrooms. And so why don't we shift then to your area of expertise, which is ed leadership, and talk about the role of principals and superintendents in helping to create educational equity.
Well, education leaders really play a large role in establishing the culture and climate of a school or school system. And so given the fact that they are the ones that are supervising instruction, they're working directly with families and students, it's really important that they also have a commitment to issues of equity and making sure that students and families that may have not been able to historically be included as part of the educational process are included and are full participants in the education of their students. So leaders play an important role in that. They set the tone, and their knowledge around understanding different cultures and culturally relevant leadership are really critical to creating those spaces that not only help students and families to feel included in the school community, but also then inform and improve academic achievement for students.
And so to what extent do ed leaders shape the budgets of their schools? Do they receive a budget or can they shape a budget?
Well, it varies greatly from state to state and district to district. I think increasingly it can be a challenge for principals, depending on the relationship between the central office and how much control they have over their own site budget. So again, there may not be as much control as many principals like in terms of how they allocate their funds, but their understanding of how to distribute those funds in ways to ensure that students are getting access to an adequate and equitable education are important. But that's critically important at the state level when we think about our state legislators and governors and how they are, one, funding education budgets, and then two, making sure that those funds are getting to the students who really need them most.
And so, if we compare where we are now from where we were 60 years ago, a common story is that segregated black schools had secondhand books that were at least 10 years old and the backs were ripped off, you know. They didn't have the kinds of science laboratories that kids at white schools had, et cetera. To what extent are we seeing ed leadership that at least is making sure that we have the same kinds of materials available in all schools?
Well, I think the issue of resource allocation is definitely at the center of the educational equity debate and whether or not we are providing students with what they need. Historically, as you mentioned, all black schools in certain parts of the country did not have access to the resources and the educational materials that they needed, or even the facilities. What we have found, though, and know, is that in other communities, some black schools actually had really nice facilities because they wanted to facilitate and continue segregation. And so in order to kind of preemptively address the issue of desegregation, some communities built really nice schools for black students so that they wouldn't have to attend the all-white schools.
Right.
I think today the landscape has shifted dramatically to where issues of race, of class, of language, of geography have to be looked at in more nuanced ways. Given the history of race in this country, we often link class and low-income communities and families or blackness to kind of low-income or lack of wealth accumulation.
Right, right.
However, we see growing class divides even within races. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, the intersection of race and income, and then again of language, immigrant status, and geography,
right,
create a kind of a different landscape on which we need to look at issues of inclusion and integration.
Right, right. You have done some research on African-American educational leaders historically and contemporaneously, and it's a story, it's another unspoken mm-hmm. history. It's seldom told in terms of what was going on in those segregated black schools that produced people of such brilliance and such talent despite the racism that they encountered in their daily lives, and schools that, while unequal in terms of facilities and resources, there was a lot of education going on there. And
mm-hmm.
so what are some of the stories of those leaders that can guide the way we think about educational leadership today?
I think there has historically always been this commitment and value for education in the black community in the United States. Although those opportunities weren't always present, it was something that, as James Anderson has written about, Vanessa Siddle Walker, that African Americans consistently fought for in wanting to ensure that their children had access to a high quality education. In my work with 8 African American superintendents, as part of my dissertation research, I wanted to kind of get a sense of their experiences in all black segregated schools as students, and then their experiences as education leaders in desegregated school systems. And so what I found across their narratives was the fact that they really appreciated and valued their schooling experience. And they didn't really talk about the tattered textbooks or the rundown schools that we often read about, but rather the caring and demanding teachers that they had, the tight relationships that parents had, many of whom may not have had access to education themselves, but the high expectations that their parents and teachers shared for them educationally, and the expectation that they would all go on to college whether they wanted to or not.
Mm-hmm.
And then even the support from community institutions, whether it was the church Or as one participant said, even the drunk on the corner knew and expected me to go to college, right. And people would actually chip in financially to make sure that students had the resources to be successful educationally. So I think it was interesting to find that across those eight cases, despite where they grew up in the country, that they had very shared experiences in their all black segregated schools.
And so how did that then shape their own leadership as educational leaders?
Well, it's certainly, I think they all had a mind towards equity and justice and ensuring that all students had equal access to educational opportunities and providing that support to students. They all spoke about the fact that it was not their job to determine who was going to be successful and who wasn't, that was above their pay grade, and that they would just need to make sure that they invested the time and resources and the teachers, quality teachers, to provide that type of support to students. So very equity-minded. Never assumed that one could determine who would be successful academically and who wouldn't, but that it was simply their responsibility to provide and challenge and push and have high expectations for all students.
And so one of the byproducts of Brown, of course, with the desegregation of public schools is that a lot of black teachers and a lot of black administrators and principals lost their jobs. And so scholars have talked about that loss, and we're now in a situation where there's not a racial match between who's the leadership of the classroom or the leadership of the school and who the students are. And so a question would be the extent to which predominantly white educational leaders can affect that same kind of climate in schools today, the same as the African-American leaders you talked about.
I definitely think they can. I think many do. It's about really your knowledge, your dispositions, and your passion around making sure that students, again, that you're not judging students and that you have and hold high expectations for all of them. And so I don't know that your race dictates whether or not you're able to make those connections with other students. Gloria Ladson Billings' work around the dream keepers and culturally relevant instructors of black children, I think attest to that. And many studies that have since been done, I think that the fact that we have about 80 to 85% of our teaching force are white middle class women, that our colleges of education have to be cognizant of the population that we're serving and the population that they're serving. And so preparing them with not only the content and pedagogical research and knowledge that they need, but giving them the clinical experience, I think, in working with what is increasingly a minority population in U.S. schools.
And so it's not just the pre-service teacher programs, but also any teacher professional development and ed leadership programs that
absolutely. I think
about, right?
You know, for many people who've been teaching for a long time, they haven't been in a university classroom for decades, and so making sure that ongoing professional development, opportunities to go into school communities, to be exposed to those historical counter-narratives and those unspoken histories of a school community are really important to understanding the people of that community and being able to build the relationships that research has shown is important to improve and increase student academic achievement.
Right. And so you've developed a typology that sort of lays out a way that somebody can self-educate around their own racialized identity and how they can develop a broader sense of cultural competence in their ed leadership capacity, in their other roles that they play in the school. Can you talk a little bit about that typology and what we can learn from that?
Sure. Well, in my book, Learning in a Burning House, I introduce a typology that I describe as a critical race approach to equal education. And so after talking about the historical context of Brown and other desegregation cases and where we find ourselves today, I really speak to the centrality of race and the issue of race in education. And it's one that we often don't like to discuss, and it can be very controversial, but my typology suggests that when we really understand what race is, as a social construct, it kind of helps us to understand how we can manage it, better understand it, and then ultimately move toward racial reconciliation, if you will.
So the first step is
racial
literacy.
So the first step is racial literacy, knowing what race is, how it functions in society, and that it often does what it was designed to do, which is to create to stratify different groups based on racial categories that were created for multiple or multitude of reasons.
Right.
And those categories change over time, and so that's how we know that they're really not real.
They're not biological.
They're not biological. Social. They're social.
Right.
The second step is racial realism, and that really draws from Derrick Bell's work, who's a critical race, father of critical race theory,
exactly.
Who says that racism is not dead. Unfortunately, it's a salient part of life in America, and recognizing that, I think, helps educators who are working in schools and are often looking at data according to racial categories help to make sense of that. The third step is racial reconstruction. And this is, I think, hopeful in the fact that we know that race is a social construct, that we can reconstruct the meanings that we attach to racial groups. And so blackness doesn't need to be associated with something negative or with, you know, the bottom portion of an achievement gap.
As it often is.
As it often
so
is.
So black and Latino kids are presumed to be incompetent and presumed to be at the bottom of the racial, the achievement gap.
Right.
And
So we've normalized failure for black and brown students to where if a black or brown student succeeds, sometimes
surprised
as opposed to expecting that success. And so how do we reconstruct our notions around what it means to be a black student, what it means to be a Latina student.
Mm-hmm.
And then finally, racial reconciliation, which is where we're able to, again, listen and respond to those unspoken histories, to accept them as part of our history, but then to be able to move forward together.
And that's the aspirational.
That's aspirational.
Part of it, right? We know that it's a lifelong struggle.
It's a lifelong, it's a process.
Right.
But I think it's a useful way to think about how we can progress consciously around issues of race and education.
So with that typology, let's then overlay what we think we understand about educational leadership, the creation of healthy schools, strong schools, racially, culturally competent schools, high-achieving schools. What could a person do if they're not going to get the kind of professional development that uses your typology effectively, but they wanted to self-educate around that? How could a principal, how could a superintendent, how could, you know, sort of a grade level leader sort of think about, okay, I want to learn, I want to change, I want to make my school a place where all feel welcome and all know that they're going to get a high quality of education. What could that person do?
I think one of the first things I would recommend are talking to the people of the community that you're working in, listening to their own experiences and their perspectives and those unspoken histories. I think history is really important to this process, which is why we recognized the Brown versus Board of Education decision in acknowledging that many of the issues that we faced in 1954 are still with us today. But that we've also made a lot of progress. And so acknowledging that as well and realizing that we can continue to grow is the more that we, again, listen to other people's perspectives and begin to kind of reflect and maybe question some of our own biases and assumptions around other students or families or communities. And with that new knowledge, I think, be able to move forward on the path to racial reconciliation.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What other things can be helpful to us to help rebuild this world?
In 30 seconds or less?
You have more than 30 seconds.
Well, you know, I think this is why the issue of school integration is really so important. Much of my work has looked at some of the negative consequences of school desegregation, but it's not to suggest that I don't support integration or that that is not the way to go. And I think we need to continue to really demonstrate advocacy towards ensuring that all students, but particularly young people, have a chance to be in spaces with people who are different than them.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the benefits of that are going to be important to creating, you know, that beloved community that Dr. King spoke about. But building those one-on-one cross-racial relationships, being in spaces that may be different from us, but being able to put ourselves in someone else's shoes. So I think building empathy, building racial literacy, understanding and appreciating that we all have our own worldview, but it may not be the same as someone else's. And being able to negotiate and discuss those things freely would be important to building that type of community.
Right. Schools are inherently conservative institutions, right? At least I'll assert that they are. And so it's going to be the courageous educational leader who really steps out and says, I want my school to be a model of high achieving, well integrated schools where everybody has a chance mm-hmm. to do well. What kind of spiritual support will that educational leader need to exercise that kind of courage?
Well, I mean, having a network of support is really important. And I think, you know, the onus does not fall simply on the building leaders or even the central office administration. I think we really need to look to our policymakers and individuals who are setting policy and establishing budgets at the state level because education is a state responsibility. We see some states that do a very good job of funding schools adequately and equitably and others that don't. And so it takes, and I think the challenge with really changing and improving education is that there are so many layers involved and making sure that at every level we have individuals who are bold and courageous and are really working together to actively advance education in this country that reflects what America is about, and that's access and opportunity. And school serving as a great equalizer, and that no matter where you're born or where you come from, that you have the ability to access all that this country has to offer. And so we have,
no, go ahead.
We have a ways to go.
Well, I mean, you've also talked about the ways in which our diversity, the diversity of this country, is our strength. And mm-hmm. when we're thinking in terms of education as an engine for global competition, mm-hmm. global competition, that by tapping into the strength of our diversity, we position ourselves differently in the world. Can you speak more about that?
We are living in the World House, as Dr. King mentioned in his Nobel Peace Prize speech. He, in the late 1960s, had already kind of envisioned this world where we'd be so interconnected. And he said we're going to be interdependent, so we've got to find ways to live together as one big family. And I think schools can really serve as a metaphor for that. If we don't learn how to leverage the rich racial and cultural diversity that we have in this country, the linguistic diversity that we have, the geographic diversity that we have, we are going to find ourselves even more isolated. And I think it's important that we recognize it as a strength and not a deficit, and that will really depend whether or not we can move forward as a nation in strength and in unity.
Mm-hmm. In considering where we are post-Brown, and notions of the achievement gap and whether we're better off or worse off. There's also a conversation about neighborhood schools and whether that's going to be a more nurturing place for African American kids. And you're working on an article in that regard.
I am. I'm working on a piece currently entitled Neighborhood Schools Post-Millikan, Community Empowerment or Romance of the Ghetto School. Mm-hmm. And it's really framed according to an article that Jonathan Kozol wrote in 1994. And he was critiquing the Millikan versus Bradley decision in Detroit, which prohibited metropolitan desegregation plan. So it said that the suburban school districts, which were primarily white, did not have an obligation to desegregate the Detroit public schools, which were predominantly black. And so he critiques that decision as really, you know, undermining Brown and the promise of Brown. And he also talks about this idea of romance of the ghetto school, where he argues that many African Americans have supported all black de facto segregated schools,
right,
as places where they could provide empowerment,
right,
culturally autonomous schools,
right,
where the values and the needs of black students could better be met. And he says that that really isn't the way to go, and that too undermines the push and advocacy around school integration. And so this piece really kind of revisits that question that Du Bois posed in 1935 when he asked, does the Negro need separate schools?
Right.
And he ultimately decided in 1935 that while all children really just need a proper education, and that until we had perfect equality, it might be better for black students to be in spaces where they're nurtured and their cultural background is supported. And so I think this is a question that we continue to grapple with today. I think while many people do support school integration, the challenges that we find in making that a reality result in many people wondering how we then provide quality education in neighborhood schools that are that way because of residential segregation.
Right, right, right. And this, again, is where educational leadership can take a stand, perhaps. I mean, it's hard to say whether the single principal or the single superintendent can overcome all of the issues that are brought up by an article like this. But
I think awareness around the issue and the debate that has been going on for a very long time now is important for leaders and how they lead in their buildings.
Right. Thank you.
Thank you.
You've been watching Urban Education, Issues and Solutions.